Good morning, everybody. How are you guys doing today?
Good.
Woo! You guys are like four times louder than they were this morning. Good job. My name's Pastor Mark. I'm one of the pastors around here. And I just want to welcome everybody here today. And I want to do a little experiment with you guys. I want you to think back to this past week. So let's take a second. Let's think back to this past week. So this morning, before we start to worship, as you're thinking back through this past week, I want you guys to think about laying down any anxiety you had this past week, any tiredness, any sickness, any sin or unrighteousness, and lay it down at the feet of Jesus this morning. That's something that Jesus tells us to do, to lay our burdens at his feet, and he will take on our burdens. So this morning, as we're going to stand up here in just a second and worship, let's worship on the rock. Let's worship on our foundation. Let's worship on Jesus' love. I'm going to read a piece of scripture to you. It is the most quoted scripture by scripture in the Bible. And it is Exodus 34, 6 and 7. And it talks about who God is. The Lord. The Lord is a compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger and abounding in faithful love and truth, maintaining faithful love to a thousand generations, forgiving inequity, rebellion, and sin, but he will not leave the guilty unpunished. So stand with me this morning and let's worship the God of love and a justful God.
Hey! the price for all my guilty. Who would care that much about me? Let me tell you about my Jesus. Oh, he makes a way. mercy is more. And sometimes these songs kind of say the same thing over and over and over and over. But it never, it's like, how come these songs never get old? It's because truths like that never stop being the truth. There's never a time where I don't need to be reminded that there is a debt I could never afford. And Jesus looked on me and paid that price because he loves me and he wanted to. Man, your sins are many, but his love and his mercy is more. And that is good news for us. Amen. Well, Resurrection Church, I'm happy you're here. I love being here. I love worshiping with you. Why don't you tell that to the person next to you that you love worshiping with them. You're glad they're here. We'll be back in a few.
Hello, everyone. I'm Jessica Michael, and I'm the Children's Director here at Res Church. I am so excited that you're joining us here today. If you're here in person, hello. In the pews in front of you, you'll see two cards. One of them says, I'm new here. If you're new here, please fill this out so that we can get to know you a little better and to help get you connected here at Res Church. There's another card there that says, I need prayer. If you're in need of prayer, please fill this out. And you can put both of those cards in the offering boxes either here or in the foyer. And we have a prayer team that meets every week and they pray for you. All right. If you're here online, I also want to say hello. Can we say hello to online? There they are. All right, online, hello to you as well. Let us know that you're here. Open up the chat and click the I'm glad to be here button. If you're new, you can fill out the online connection card and that will appear in the chat. And if you need prayer, we also have hosts online that will pray with you. Okay, I'm excited to share with you an update on something new that we're going to be doing here and start seeing here at Res.
Hey guys, it's Pastor Mark here. I have some exciting news for you today. I want to talk about a project that we're going to be starting, and you're going to start seeing some changes around the campus, and that is going to be our lobby redesign project. This project is going to take some time. We're going to be moving slowly but surely, but we're going to be adding in some new seating areas, some information walls, and a next steps area. The heart or the mission behind why we're doing this isn't to create a super cool lobby, although we feel like it will be a super cool lobby, but it's more we want to connect this to our ongoing mission of connecting to the community around us. We really want to be able to create a space where, whether it be before service, in between the service, or after service, you can gather, you can create community, and you can love on each other well. The second thing is we want to be able to empower you to be in the know by having resources available to you in the lobby. You're going to start seeing these changes almost immediately, but it's going to take time to complete the whole project. We are really excited about this project, and we hope you are too. That's the update for this week. We'll see you in the lobby.
We want everyone who walks through our doors to feel at home, and redesigning the lobby is just one of the ways that we are helping to build avenues for Christian community. If you want to know more about what's coming up at Res, next Sunday, August 28th, we will be having Vision Sunday. During both services, 9 and 11, we'll be sharing our vision for Res Church and where we're going in the future. There are a lot of cool things that we want to share with you, so please come and join us here next Sunday. Now for our next act of worship is the giving of our tithes and our offerings. In 1 Chronicles 29, David says that all we have is from the Lord and belongs to the Lord. Our tithes and offerings go towards getting kingdom work done, not only here, but around the world. There are three ways that you can give. You can give on our app, You can place your offering in an envelope like this and put it in our offering boxes, or you can give online. Give online at resurrect.church. When you get there, you'll see the giving tab and select online giving. Fill out a short form, and there you go. All right, now I'd like to pray for our offering and for our message. Lord, we ask for your hand of blessing over our tithes and offerings. Lord, and for the message we are about to hear. Thank you, Lord, for everything. Please open our hearts and our minds to your word, God. In your precious and holy name we pray. Amen.
Morning. My name is Pastor Daniel, and I'm excited to be here. We've been doing a couple, this year we've done a couple of these. This is called Preacher Journal. And so Preacher Journal is where we ask the preaching pastor to open up their prayer journal and kind of look at where and how God's been moving in their life and things that God's been teaching them specifically, and then be vulnerable enough to come in on a Sunday and tell you all about the things that God has been doing with them privately. And so your job today is to kind of listen to the personal experience of what God's been doing, and then really seek the guidance of the Holy Spirit to illuminate you as we go through Scripture, as we look at what is really a testimonial each time we do one of these of your preaching pastors. And so I'm excited to get to do this. Someone asked me after first service, did you take an energy drink? You're darn right I did. I took 4 weeks off. That's what I said. Okay, I'm ready. All right, so here's what we're going to do. I'm going to walk through just what I think is a problem that I struggle with and that you may struggle with. I just want to kind of set it up, and then we're going to unpack that, and I think it'll take a minute or so to get to that sort of definitionally and sort of trying to set the stage for that, and then I'll see if we can answer the question. And this is the question. Do you ever feel like in life that, I don't know, this sort of overwhelming sometimes, overwhelming just dissatisfaction. I would even call it like discontentment with life. Like it's not enough. Like it's not inspiring or thriving or exceptional. It's just like there has to be something more. And in fact, maybe if you've ever felt that way, you can't even put it into words. Like you can't articulate it. You just feel like, I'm struggling with this. And I want to submit to you. I believe that this feeling is actually the human condition, that every person ever in history since Adam and Eve have struggled with this, and we all suffer from it. And in order to kind of illustrate how prevalent this feeling is, I want to show you the trailer from a movie from about 10 years ago. And there's a guy, and he's facing this just dissatisfaction. Like he's never really done anything in life. It's like, it's not enough. And it's a great movie, Bob. It's really cute. And so just open your imagination for a few moments as you watch this and see if you can relate to this guy. Here you go.
How can I help you today?
Hi, I can't seem to leave a wink for someone.
Okay, I'm looking at your profile. You left a lot of this stuff blank.
Well, I haven't really been anywhere noteworthy or mentionable.
Have you done anything noteworthy, mentionable?
Have ahead of us the privilege of publishing the very last issue of Life magazine.
Jumping up and down the floor.
And for the final issue, we just received negative 25 from Sean O'Connell for the cover.
It's 25.
It's not there.
I know.
Look what I found!
What's that?
Travel journal Dad gave me.
The sun was an okay guy.
Hey!
Hey.
Hey.
How was your weekend?
I had an awesome weekend.
The ice, Jace. She moves like a woman.
I'd like to climb your hair.
Oh, wow.
What is it you call it when he goes into one of his little places?
Oh, zoned out.
You do that now and then.
What's the matter?
I lost a picture.
I like mysteries. You should go. Crack the case.
You were Sean's partner. You finish his work.
Himalayas, I'm not gonna keep this short. I have to make oxygen choices.
How many people have seen that movie? It's like 10 years old. Okay, I love the movie. I absolutely love it. I highly recommend it because, in my opinion, one, I get little goosebumps when I get to watch it, but it speaks to what I believe is the human condition, this idea that there's just gotta be more. Now, because it's Hollywood and it's secular, the answer is simply bravery and a passport, right? And if that was it, boy, we could just all travel a little bit internationally and we'd all be okay and everyone would be satisfied and content and this would all go away. I would submit to you that actually doesn't work. Traveling internationally is fun. It doesn't solve the problem. It makes for a phenomenal movie, but it doesn't solve the problem. And I want to double down on this. I think that everyone ends up here at some point in their life. And in fact, sometimes for lots of seasons and periods and times in our life. And so we actually fill up our life a lot of times with trying to distract ourselves from feeling this way. And cover it up with busyness or pursuits or even self-medicating our way through this with drugs or alcohol or any other sort of addiction to just sort of tell ourselves maybe we'll fix it with travel and adventure and courage and a new relationship, a new job. But deep down at the center of every human heart is this intense need for God. And something went wrong long ago, and since the Garden of Eden, we've been trying to fill it and not understanding why we can't. And so we eat and we eat and we eat and we're never full, or we drink and we drink and we drink and we're still thirsty. And King Solomon in the Bible figured this out many, many years ago in Ecclesiastes 1 when he writes, "All things are full of weariness. A man cannot utter it. The eye is not satisfied with seeing, nor is the ear filled with hearing. For what has been is what will be." How depressing. "And what has been done is what will be done. And there is nothing new under the sun." Verse 14, "I have seen everything that is done under the sun, and behold, all is vanity and striving after wind. What is crooked cannot be made straight, and what is lacking cannot be counted." Consider for a moment that King Solomon is the richest man that ever lived. The Bible says he was the wisest man that ever lived. He had a massive empire. He lived an exotic life full of everything you could imagine, hundreds of wives and concubines and military success. He was a builder, a leader. He was accomplished and famous and adored, and he was wealthy, and yet seemingly hopeless, dissatisfied, looks at every human endeavor and says, "Vanity, useless, meaningless." Have you ever felt like that? Have you had moments like that? Or do you stop and just wonder, is this is this it? Is this it? Is this all there is? I want to speak specifically to you today about the Christian life. You see, Jesus came to pay for our sin. He came to pay this debt and to free us from the penalty of it. That's true. But he came for more than just saving us from hell. Like, yes, it's true that Jesus' blood saves us from God's judgment and his wrath. But if we stop there, we'll miss what the beauty of what Jesus has done and will do in this life, not just in our next life. Only through Jesus do you and I get a restored relationship with the Father. And only because of Jesus is there a possibility of fixing this thing that seems like it's missing. But Jesus' desire for you and I is to live a life that is more consistent with how we were created, to be in constant relationship with our Creator, because that's how you and I were designed. And that's why it feels like something's missing. Jesus wants you and I to thrive. Not simply to survive, to thrive. Listen to John chapter 10, verse 10. Listen to Jesus speak about this. He's talking to the Pharisees. He's explaining some stuff. He's used some illustrations. And then he says this in verse 10. The thief, Satan, the thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly, not barely scrape by, not be dissatisfied, not, oh man, I hope you survive this thing. No. Abundantly. Listen to Jesus again. This is John 7, verses 37 and 38. Listen to him talk about this. On the last day of the feast, the great day, Jesus stood up and he cried out, "If anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink. Whoever believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water." It's not barely sustaining you and hoping you survive. It is overwhelming and overflowing. John 4, verse 12. He's there with the woman at the well, and she's questioning him. And she says, "Are you greater than our father Jacob? He gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did his sons and his livestock." And here's Jesus' answer. He's trying to get her to get this, like he's trying to get you to get this. Jesus said to her, "Everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks the water that I will give him will never be thirsty again. The water that I give him will become in him a spring of water, welling up into eternal life." Jesus wants you to thrive. Jesus wants you to thrive. Now, part of the reason that we struggle with the concept of thriving, that we struggle with this concept of, is this all there is that you and I think about thriving in human terms instead of in heavenly terms. So we get it wrong because we don't even have the right definition of what it means to thrive. We primarily think of success and thriving in these human terms of circumstances and control. What's happening around us and how much of it we control. Or maybe the easier way to say this is comfort and money. Comfort and money. We primarily think of success and failure in terms of comfort and money. Am I comfortable and do I have money? And we do that because we believe that those two things will allow us to feel emotionally good. And isn't it interesting that both of those things are, generally speaking, the things in human life that become temptations and idols the fastest? Let me briefly just prove to you that Jesus does not mean that to thrive in this life means that you're going to be wealthy or have easy circumstances. He actually says that himself in Matthew 19, 24. He says, "Again, I tell you, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter the kingdom of God." I don't know if you're a physics major, but camels through the eyes of needles seems kind of difficult. He also says this in John 16, 33. "I have said these things to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation." That's trouble. That's problems. That's not good circumstances. "But take heart, I have overcome the world." So when you turn on the television, or you're on Twitter, or you're somewhere, and there's some TV pastor or some Christian with the cute coffee cup quotes, and they're like, you just need to have more faith, and God wants to bless you financially. That's a lie. It's just not in here. It has nothing to do with thriving. Most of Jesus' followers in the Bible lived in abject poverty and under persecution. They faced massive persecution and tribulation, including dying the death of martyrs, and yet they thrived. So whatever abundance is, it can't be cash. I mean, it must transcend circumstances. It's got to transcend income and health and living conditions and even death. I read this quote. I really like it. It says, abundance in the Bible, abundance includes peace, purpose, destiny, a genuine purpose for living, the joy of facing any adversity, including the grave, without fear, and the ability to endure hardship with confident assurance. So I want to cover six things that I think we find in the biblical definition of abundance, of thriving. Six things. And I want you to consider this. And some of these words, I think it's easy to read right over. Okay, that sounds cute. But I want to sit here for just a minute on these six words. You ready? Peace. Purpose. Destiny. Joy. Fearlessness. And confidence. What would it look like to live a life that included all of these things at the same time? Because the Bible says that a life that included these things is a life of abundance, it's a life of thriving. It's a life of purpose and joy and peace. So let me just ask you this. Look at the six words again. Put them back up on the screen. Think about this. You cannot buy any of these things. I don't care how much money you have. You can't buy peace. It doesn't happen. And Solomon knew this, right? You can't buy actual real purpose to your life. You can't buy destiny. You can't buy joy. Some of the most miserable people are some of the wealthiest people. It doesn't make any sense, right? You can't buy fearlessness or confidence. You can't buy these things. It doesn't matter how much money you have. They're not for sale. You know what else you can't do? You can't manufacture them. I don't care if your factory is in China or the United States. It's got a little sticker that says made in the USA. You ain't making these. You can't. You know what else you can't do? You can't fake these for very long. You could try to fake contentment, right? To pretend to everybody else that you're content, but deep down, it doesn't last because I know, in those still quiet moments when I gotta think about it and it ain't happening, and I know there's not contentment and satisfaction, and it's not, right? You can fake them for a little while, but you ain't gonna fake them for very long. They don't like exist in a virtual world or another metaverse or something. They can't be transferred. Like, you don't get to, like, I can't take these from, inherit them from my parents, like, you know, a birthright or something. Here's some joy. Like, it doesn't work that way. So I can't buy them. I can't make them. They can't be stored up. They can't be transferred. You know what else is interesting about these six things? Put them back up again. Peace, purpose, destiny, joy, fearlessness, confidence. They ignore almost everything about our world. They ignore socioeconomic differences. You can be poor and have these. You can be rich and have these. It doesn't matter. They ignore those things. They ignore political differences. They ignore cultural differences. They ignore historical differences. They have no regard for any of the things that, for some reason, we say are really important. So how do we get them? If I can't buy them, I can't trade for them. They can't be transferred. They can't be inherited. I can't make them up. I can't manufacture them. None of these things around the earth, like socioeconomic or political or cultural things, actually make them or matter at all. How do I get them? Because I want more. I want to thrive. I don't want to survive. Two parts in the Bible about this. Number one, I got to get them. Number two, how do I keep them and walk in them long term? Well, how do I get them in the first place? I'll go right back to the scripture we started with in John 10. John 10, Jesus is describing, he's talking about this illustration to basically a bunch of Pharisees, and he's using a shepherding analogy, which they would have understood pretty well back in the first century. And in verse 7, it says this. I'm going to back up a couple of verses and read it to you. It says, so Jesus said again said to them, because he's already done this once, "Truly, truly, I say to you, I am the door of the sheep." Can we just be honest? That's kind of a weird phrase. Because sheep have like legs and wool, but they don't have doors. I've not seen that before. That's a weird thing, right? I am the door of the sheep. It makes way more sense if you lived in the first century. It makes very little sense to me in 2022. I don't own any sheep. I am the door of the sheep. What does he mean? In that time, a shepherd would take their sheep out during the day to graze them and make sure they ate. And then at night, the shepherd needed to protect them from predators, protect them from enemies, protect them from being eaten or killed. And so they had these things called sheepfolds, and they would build them, or they would be natural with rocks around them. And the sheepfold would be a big protective area. And the door is not what you and I are thinking of. Like we have doors with hinges and handles and locks and bars. And it was just an opening, just a narrow opening. And they would put all the sheep in there, but there's no door. So how do I protect them? The shepherd lays in the door all night long. You see what Jesus is saying? If you want contentment, if you want protection, if you want abundance, you got to go through me. It's me. I'm the door. All who came before me are thieves and robbers. Every person who has offered you at some point in your life some solution, some magic pill, some magic beans, some version of abundance of you, man, if you just travel more, they're lying or they're misled. There's one door, it's Jesus. But the sheep did not listen to them. I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture, satisfaction, abundance. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I come that they may have life and have it abundantly. Do you see what he's trying to say? It's me, the thing you want. It's me, the only way to contentment. It's me. Real contentment is found in how trustworthy the shepherd is and how much we put our faith and trust in him. Jesus lays in the opening of the sheepfold because he's the gate. This is the gospel. This is the good news. Not just that we're saved from our debt and our sin and our dysfunction, but that there's more because of Jesus. The way to that is through Jesus. Now, if you're like me, you're thinking, man, I agree. Man, Pastor Daniel, I'm a Christian. I put my faith in Jesus. I just like you. I mean, I believe these things, and I go to church, and I read my Bible, and I try to check the boxes and do the things and love the God. But how come I don't feel like this in my life? How come I don't feel like I'm swimming in peace and purpose and destiny and joy and fearlessness and confidence? If I'm saved, how come I feel like I want more? How come I feel like there's still dissatisfaction and discontentment and there's more to life than just like... I hope, and this is where what you're going to find in my prayer journal, I hope you can relate to this, but there's just times where I look at things like peace and purpose and destiny and joy, and I understand them intellectually. I know what I read. I know I have faith in God, but why don't I feel that way? It's like looking in a photo album at an old picture of yourself, and you're like, did I really look like that? Wow, that's a lot thinner. Some of you are like, I had a lot more hair. Amen. You It's like you know that you know that it happened. Like there was some point where I put my life in Jesus' hands and everything felt vibrant and exciting and dynamic and inspiring, and I would have dropped everything and I would have ran after him to the ends of the earth and nothing mattered except for Jesus. But why don't I feel like that right now? How come I gotta look at the photo album to remember it? I know I'm saved, but is this it? Is this the whole thing? Because I want more. And how do I get back to that? How do I get back to feeling like I did when Jesus was my everything? Because what I'm submitting to you today is that we were intended to live like that, that inspired, that content, that satisfied in Jesus through the Christian walk, not just that one time at summer camp. And it's all throughout the Old Testament. I picked one story, or New Testament, I picked one story just so you could see what I'm talking about. This is in Acts 16. This is Paul and Silas. They've been saved for a while, particularly Paul. He's not a new Christian, and his circumstances, they're really bad, and he's broke. Verse 19 of Acts 16, but when her owners saw that their hope of gain was gone, so backstory, there's a demon-possessed girl who's making money for some people who are taking advantage of her, and Paul and Silas cast the demon out, and people get mad because their money-making scheme is gone. Just your everyday thing that you probably run into, casting demons out and stuff. And they seized Paul and Silas, and they dragged them into the marketplace before the rulers. And when they had brought them to the magistrates, they said, "These men are Jews, and they are disturbing our city." That's a lie. "They advocate customs that are not lawful for us as Romans to accept or practice." Another lie. "The crowd joined in attacking them," false accusations, "and the magistrates tore the garments off of them and gave orders to beat them with rods." I just want to submit, that's not a great weekend. "And when they had inflicted many blows upon them, they threw them in prison, ordering the jailer to keep them safely. Having received this order, he put them into the inner prison," that's the worst place, "and fastened their feet in the stocks." Verse 25, about midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the prisoners were listening to them. Come on. That's what I want. No, I don't want to be beaten with rods. Take that back, God. Or thrown in the inner cells of the prison. But what is it that gets me there that I could be beaten and thrown in prison and falsely accused, and yet my only response is a midnight praise session? That's what I want, because I want more. To be beaten for your faith, jailed, thrown in stocks, falsely accused, and your response is joy and praise. It's peace, purpose, destiny, joy, fearlessness, and confidence in the middle of a prison. But how do we do that? How do we come to the point in our life, not just that we admit we need Jesus, most of us that are, if you're a believer, you already did that. You repented. You put your faith in Jesus. But how do I get back to this place where life is that dynamic? Three things. If you're taking notes, three things. You ready? We finally got to the sermon. It took me a little while to warm up. It's been a few weeks, okay? I wore my new preaching shoes. You like, no? Okay. I like them. It always means I'm going to go long. All right, moving on. Number one, three things. Number one, thriving is not a thing that happens to you. It's a thing that happens in you. This is really important, okay? Because we get caught up in circumstances all the time. In the Bible, this life of abundance is not a thing that happens to you. It's a thing that happens in you. I want you to hear it. John 15, 4 through 9. Listen to what he says. This is Jesus trying to explain this Christian life, because we're not going to get it. We're going to keep focusing on circumstances, and Jesus is going to keep telling us that that's not it. Verse 4, abide in me as I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine. You are the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. How much? Not even a little bit. Not even a little bit of righteousness. Not even a little bit of satisfaction. Not even a little bit of contentment. Apart from me, you got nothing. That's so encouraging. Listen, if you thought he stuttered, he just doubles down in verse 6. If anyone does not abide in me, he's thrown away like a branch and withers. Do you ever feel like you're withering? Because if I'm being honest, if I open up my prayer journal, there's just seasons where I feel like I'm withering and I'm not content and I'm not satisfied. I'm going, is this really it? This can't be it. Treading water. The branches are gathered, thrown into the fire and burned. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. By this my Father is glorified that you bear much fruit to prove to be my disciples. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Abide in my love. Okay, step one. Are you with me? I want more. Say, I want more. I want more to this Christian life than treading water and surviving. Step one, it's not what happens to me. It's something that happens in me. And Jesus would say, abide in me and I in you. So there's this idea that, man, if you get disconnected from me, from Jesus, from the love of Christ, it's literally going to feel like withering and dying. And I can tell you again and again, if you flip through the pages of my prayer journal, how often it's felt like withering and dying. So what do I do then? If it happens in me, how do I make it happen? Two things. We're gonna see them right here. The first one is this. I'm going to insert into my life things that stir up my affection and passion and love for Jesus, okay? Now where does this come from? It comes in a lot of places. I'm gonna read you one verse. This is in Hebrews 10:24. It says this, and let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works. Now, this is in that famous passage in Hebrews where we're talking about don't neglect to meet together, that everybody wanted to use and quote that verse during COVID as like the justification that we could shake our fist at the government. But that wasn't what the verse was about at all. What the verse was about is understand why we meet together in the first place. We don't meet together so that God can be praised, because we're supposed to be praising God all the time. So yes, we have a worship service. Yes, we give God glory and praise, absolutely. But the primary reason we come to do it together is to stir one another up into good works and encourage one another, because life can be discouraging. Now let me ask you a question. If naturally you got saved and you were always just on this high, this mountaintop experience like you were right after you got saved maybe, why would you need to be stirred up? Why would there be a command to stir each other up if it just happened on its own? Spoiler alert. It doesn't happen on its own. We have to put some work into encouraging one another, stirring one another up. You're like, stir up. What does stir up mean? Have you ever had like a five-year-old make lemonade for you? Some of you have. I can hear you laughing. And you drink it and you're like, and it's not stirred? Stir up. It takes, we're emotional creatures, are we not? We have ups and downs. Some of you guys are like, no, not at all. Sure, I've watched you watch football. Get out of here. We're emotional creatures. The Bible says, no. I need you to stir each other up. I need you to encourage each other. The love for Christ We have this tendency to drift, and what we need to do is insert into our lives affection stirrers, things that stoke the fire for our passion and pursuit of Jesus Christ. So there are specific things, and here's the interesting thing about those specific things. It's not a checklist of rules. Go figure. The things that stir up your affection for Jesus, they might actually be different from one another. I have specific things that over time I've realized really stir up my affections. And there are things that other people have that really stir up, that aren't mine. Some of these talented musicians up here get a guitar and a cup of coffee and sit there just writing a song to the Lord. Listen, me writing a song to the Lord is not gonna stir up good things. Maybe some complaints from my neighbors. Like, that's not gonna help. But you know what does stir up my affection for Jesus? When I get to hear someone else talking about something that right now Jesus is miraculously doing in their life. That may not do it for you, but I just tell you every time, look at Mufasa. Whew. When someone's like, hey, let me just tell you how Jesus is working in my life. Let me just tell you what God is doing. I'm like, whew. It stirs up my affection for Jesus. It puts my gaze back on God and out of these worldly circumstances where I get caught up in the noise of everything that's going on around me. Another one for me, there are specific worship songs. This is just specific songs. Like My Jesus is one of my songs. Like that song we sang, that second one. Oh, Let My Jesus Change Your Life wrecks me. Wrecks me. Who You Say I Am. I'm messy crying and I'm not apologizing. For me, it doesn't have to be for you. That's the whole point, right? There are things in my life that if I will commit time and energy and focus to, will stir up my affection for the Lord. And if I ignore them, I don't benefit from. Really reflecting on God's faithfulness to me when I'm not faithful. The reason I keep prayer journals is I like to go back and I like to look at how often God has dealt with my whining and my inconsistency and my rebellion and how often he's answered prayers. And most of the time I've forgotten about them and I go back and read them and I'm like, man, he is good. And it stirs my affections for Jesus. The important part of this is not that I know what mine are. It's, do you know what yours are? And I would submit that most Christians that I run into don't. You don't. You just kind of hope that it happens. And that's crazy. Let me tell you why it's crazy. Anyone that is married now, or even dating, learns really quickly how to stir up their spouse or fiance or whomever, how to stir up those affections. Amen? You guys are really quiet. It's time for a marriage seminar. Amen? Man, you figure it out, don't you? Like, I know what's going to make an impact on my wife. I know. Why? Because there's times where I go, uh-oh. Right? The affection is waning because of the stress and strain of life, and I better go and put some effort into doing things that I know matter for her. Now, if that's the case in my relationship with the Heavenly Father, when things are not, man, I realize that the passion has dwindled. Why in the world would I not have things that I know will stir up my affection for the Lord? And a lot of them, are things that you can only do with other believers, which is why we have such an emphasis on the Sunday morning gathering, why we have such an emphasis on community groups, why we have an emphasis on discipleship and work with other believers, because we have to stir one another up to love and good works. The flip side, so if one side of this is stirring up affection, the other side is I have to remove things from my life that are affection suckers. You know what I'm talking about. There are things in my life that will suck out the affection for Jesus. There are things in my life that remove passion, that pour cold water on the coals that I'm trying to stoke up of affection for Jesus, that distract me, the distractions and riches of life. There are specific things. Listen to Jesus when he's talking in Matthew 5. He's trying to express this idea of righteousness in relationship is not just this big rule set. Matthew 5, verses 27 through 30 says this: "You have heard it said, you shall not commit adultery. But I say to you that everyone who looks at a woman with lustful intent has already committed adultery with her in his heart. If your right eye causes you to sin, tear it out and throw it away. For it is better that you lose one of your members than that your whole body be thrown into hell. And if your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off and throw it away. For it is better for you to lose one of your members than that your whole body go to hell." Listen, Jesus is not telling you to cut off your hand. We all get that, right? Two people get that. You're going to have a lot of left-handed people here next week. Jesus is saying that when it comes to relationship with him, there's no rule book somewhere that's going to perfectly dictate how to go about doing this. Instead, what he's saying is oftentimes in our relationship, the things that pull our affection away from Jesus are morally neutral things. There's nothing wrong with this guy's eye. There's nothing wrong with a hand. Those are good things. There are things in my life. They're morally neutral. They're not bad. They're not good. They're just things. And I've identified over time, those things begin to pull my affection and my attention and my energy and my away from Jesus. And Jesus would say, cut them off and throw them out. Cut them off and throw them out. Are they bad? No, they're not bad. But if they impact, if they pull you away from Christ, cut them off and throw them out. I have just pursuits, just things that if I know at this point, if I get too far into that, it's going to be a problem for me. For me, a really, really interesting video game is really dangerous. Because it's bad? No. Because it will pull my focus and my attention and my affection away from Christ. You know what another one is for me? Politics. Not even one specific part of politics, just basically the whole thing. If I begin to focus at all on politics, I just find my heart just drifting off into the who knows where, right? And it's not God. Is it bad? No, it's not bad until it impacts my pursuit of Christ. Here's another one for me. Eating poorly does. Not the first day or second day or maybe usually about the second year. Eating poorly, not having a schedule for my time when I wake up and go to sleep. This may not be yours. Listen, it doesn't have to be yours. These are mine. I've found that over time, if I get lazy and lackadaisical with it, the next thing you know, we're a few weeks down, a few months down the road, and I am not pursuing the Lord the way that I was. What does that mean? It means I don't have the luxury of that if I want more. And listen, I want more. I don't want to just survive. So when I find that it's not doing what it needs to, when I find it's pulling my affection away, I got to cut it off and I got to throw it away. What are yours? What are yours? What are the things that in your life, they're not bad, they're not good, they're morally neutral things, there's nothing wrong, no one's going to shame you because you have it in your life, but you know that too much of that begins to pull your affection away from the Lord. It begins to sap away the very abundance, the thriving that God has put you in your life. And here's how you probably know, God's probably been talking to you about it for a while. And your justification for keeping it is, well, it's not bad, it's not sinful, right? I got really quiet in here. That is so weird. Because every single one of us have them. We know we have them. We go read the parable of the sower where the seed's falling in the land. There's that one seed that falls into good, fertile ground. And as it grows up, everything's good until the thorns, the riches and worries of life grow with it, choke it out. What are yours? And here's my real question. What are you going to do about them? What are you going to do about them? Because it's one thing for me to look at something in my life, too much TV. Maybe that's it for me. Too much TV. Like, not bad, not good, just a thing. Like, there's this cool show called Alone, where they take people out into the middle of nowhere and they drop them off with like absolutely nothing, and they're not even allowed to talk to anybody, and they see who can survive the longest without going insane. It's amazing. I've watched 8 seasons of it. Like a survival expert from my bedroom. You've never seen someone hypocritical until I'm eating popcorn and lecturing on the person that hasn't eaten in 9 days, like, so weak mentally. Maybe it's TV. Maybe, but see, here's the thing. The things that in your life that would pull your affection away from Christ, you could intellectually, academically, in a vacuum go, I could live without that. I could do without that. I could get rid of it. And I was like, cool, do it today. It gets a little more, all of a sudden it's like, today? What if we looked at that as like a 2023 New Year's resolution? In fact, the very idea that removing it from my life gives me a little bit of apprehension and fear. Probably a really good sign that has a little bit too much of a hold on you. But in my journal, after the 19th time the Holy Spirit has talked to me about it, and I'm finally willing to write it out on a piece of paper and read it back to myself, if I want more, if he's worth it, I will get rid of it. So for me, the presence of alcohol in my home led me to pursue Jesus slower. So I had to take it all and throw it in the trash can. Because it was morally bad? No. Because it robbed me of my affection for Jesus. And he's worth it. Does this make sense? Does this make sense? I want more. What are yours? Are they worth getting rid of? Because at some point, every single one of us has to face the question, when the Holy Spirit has brought that thing into our life and showed it to us and put it in front of us, we have to answer the question, is Jesus worth more? Is he worth more? I want to remind you, and I don't think this gets talked about enough in churches, that the Christian life was never intended to be boring. It was never intended to be this dull, rudimentary thing where we all just kind of made our way through life for the next 45 years until we could finally make it to heaven and woo, survive that thing. It was meant to be vibrant and abundant and exotic and inspirational to the extent that you could be in prison in stocks at midnight singing joyfully with confidence in the Lord. And to get there, we have to be willing to understand that all of that comes through the gatekeeper, through the shepherd, and only by stirring up our affections and removing things that suck away our affections, are we gonna have an opportunity to continue to stay in the vibrancy of that pursuit of Christ? I want joyful, fearless, destiny, purpose, peace, contentment in my life. And I want it for you too. So here's my first question. If you're here today or you're online and you sort of joined us through this rabbit trail, do you know him? Do you know the Good Shepherd? Because there'll be a lot of stories and a lot of theories and a lot of assertions of what is going to lead you to abundance in your life. Only one is the Good Shepherd. Everything else the Bible would call wolves and enemies and thieves. Only one leads to actual contentment and satisfaction, and everything else leads to more thirst and more brokenness and more dysfunction. Do you know him? Have you put your life in his hands? Our elders and prayer team and pastors are going to be up here in just a minute. And if you've never done that, I want to encourage you to take a step forward to do that. Come and talk to us about next steps. What does it look like to put my faith in Jesus Christ and move forward? We want to walk with you through that. Jesus' desire, our desire, is that everyone would live in the vibrancy of a pursuit of Christ. Secondly, are you in a season of your life where it feels just terrible, hopeless? You're left wondering, is this all there really is? I want to invite you into taking some steps in your life to stir up your affection for Jesus, to talk to the Lord about things that might be robbing you of your affection for Jesus. If you'd like to have prayer over that, if you'd like to talk to an elder or a prayer team member about that, we invite you to come and discuss it with us. If you simply want to come to the altar and repent and talk to God and beg him to show you that, do it. Do it. Don't allow this life to be just one Sunday to the next of surviving. You're missing out on the goodness of God in your life. Repent and commit your affection to him. Dietrich Bonhoeffer says this in his biography. It says, being a Christian is less about cautiously avoiding sin than about courageously and actively doing God's will. Amen. Let me pray over you today. God, we thank you so much for your son, not just saving us from ourselves and our sin, God, but bringing with his death and resurrection and power, a life more abundant. God, we desire to live lives that are just inspirational. God, that are inexplicable apart from the power of your word and your son. God, I pray for our church that we would individually and corporately chase after you, throw off the noise and distractions of this world, run after you all the more. We love you. We thank you, God, that you refuse to leave us where we're at, that you continue to redeem us, make your mercies new every day. In Jesus' name, amen. You move as the Lord leads you.
Everything. Real contentment is found in our shepherd who cares for us and takes care of us. He wants us to thrive in him. Don't forget to stir it up. I'd like to encourage you to remember that the God who is with us during this time of worship is with you always. He is there for you in all times. I also want you to know that you are prayed for and loved. Please open your hands and receive the Lord's rest, grace, and peace. 1 Thessalonians 5:23 says, "Now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ." Lord Jesus, thank you for being with us always. Thank you for being our true peace and contentment. Thank you for caring for us so very much. Help us to remember daily that your loving spirit is always with us. Amen. Have a great day.